Good morning and welcome to worship at St. James Lutheran Church. Thank you for joining us for this seventh Sunday after Pentecost. God is good. All the time.
God is good.
Let us pray. O God, from you come all holy desires, all good counsels, and all just works. Give to us, your servants, that peace which the world cannot give, that our hearts may be set to obey your commandments. And also that we, being defended from the fear of our enemies, may live in peace and quietness through Jesus Christ, our Savior and Lord. Amen.
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 praise and thanksgiving, God, we would offer. For all things living, you have made good. Harvest of sown fields, fruits of the orchard, hay from the mown fields, blossom and wood. God bless the labor we bring to sow. Rejoicing with us, all others may know your care. Then will your blessing reach every people, freely confessing your gracious hand. Where you are reigning, no one will hunger. Your love sustains.
Reading from Amos. This is what the Lord God showed me. The Lord was standing beside a wall built with a plumb line, with a plumb line in his hand. And the Lord said to me, Amos, what do you see? And I said, a plumb line. Then the Lord said, see, I am setting a plumb line in the midst of my people Israel. I will never again pass them by. The high places of Isaac shall be made desolate, and the sanctuaries of Israel shall be laid waste. And I will rise against the house of Jeroboam with the sword. Then Amaziah, the priest of Bethel, sent to King Jeroboam of Israel, saying, Amos has conspired against you in the very center of the house of Israel. The land is not able to bear all his words. For thus Amos has said, Jeroboam shall die by the sword, and Israel must go into exile away from his land. And Amaziah said to Amos, O seer, go, flee away to the land of Judah, earn your bread there and prophesy there, but never again prophesy at Bethel, for it is the king's sanctuary and it is a temple of the kingdom. Then Amos answered Amaziah, I am no prophet nor a prophet's son, but I am a herdsman and a dresser of sycamore trees. And the Lord took me from following the flock, and the Lord said to me, go, prophesy to my people Israel. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
For this morning comes from Mark's gospel. King Herod heard of the disciples' preaching, for Jesus' name had become known. Some were saying, John the Baptizer has been raised from the dead, and for this reason these powers are at work in him. But others said, it is Elijah, and others said, it is a prophet, like one of the prophets of old. But when Herod heard of it, he said, John, whom I beheaded, has been raised. For Herod himself had sent men who arrested John, bound him, and put him in prison on account of Herodias, his brother Philip's wife, because Herod had married her. For John had been telling Herod, it is not lawful for you to have your brother's wife. And Herodias had a grudge against him and wanted to kill him, but she could not. For Herod feared John, knowing that he was a righteous and holy man, and he protected him. When he heard him, he was greatly perplexed, and yet he liked to listen to him. But an opportunity came when Herod, on his birthday, gave a banquet for his courtiers and officers and for the leaders of Galilee. When his daughter Herodias came in and danced, she pleased Herod and his guests. And the king said to the girl, "Ask me for whatever you wish, and I will give it." And he solemnly swore to her, "Whatever you ask me, I will give you, even half of my kingdom." She went out and said to her mother, "What should I ask for?" She replied, "The head of John the Baptizer." Immediately she rushed back to the king and requested, "I want you to give me at once the head of John the Baptist on a platter." The king was deeply grieved, yet out of regard for his oaths and for the guests, he did not want to refuse her. Immediately the king sent a soldier of the guard with orders to bring John's head. He went and beheaded him in the prison, brought his head on a platter, and gave it to the girl. The girl gave it to her mother. When his disciples heard about it, they came and took his body and laid it in a tomb. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Good morning, boys and girls. Thank you for joining us for worship. I'm glad that we can be together this way. I hope that you have had a great week. I hope you're having a great morning so far. And so for our children's time this morning, I'm going to show you in just a few seconds a picture. And I want you to take a good look at it. I'm only going to show it to you for a few seconds. And I want you to pay close attention, okay? Are you ready? Okay, here it is. Okay, got it? Good. You know, I really love rainbows. It's really exciting when you see a rainbow in the sky, and sometimes around here this time of year you get to see them. You know, in the summertime when the air is hot, maybe a thunderstorm or a rain shower passes through and then the sun comes back out but the clouds are still in the sky, that bright rainbow just takes up the whole sky. Sometimes we get to see a little bit of it, sometimes we get to see that full rainbow, but I really, really love it when I see those bright colors, when it's really bright and vibrant with that rainbow shining in the sky. To me, it's always a moment where I stop and I look at it for as long as I can. If I have my phone with me, I try to take a nice picture of it too. Rainbows are so cool, and maybe you feel the same way. Okay, now quick question. What was that picture that I showed you just a minute or two ago? If you said smiley face, you were right. And that probably wasn't too hard to remember that. It was probably pretty easy, even though I didn't talk about smiley faces at all. What I said probably didn't distract you from the big picture that I showed you at the beginning of our children's time. I'm sure you still remembered. Even though I talked about rainbows, you remembered that I showed you a picture of a smiley face. In our Bible story for this morning, we find out that lots and lots of people are talking about Jesus. People who knew him or knew someone who knew him. All kinds of people are telling other people all about Jesus. And this is really good because lots and lots of people are excited about Jesus and all that he's doing. But in our lesson for today, we also learned that some people weren't excited at all. And they tried to stop people from talking about Jesus, stop paying attention to Jesus. They're trying to distract everyone that's so excited about Jesus and make them pay attention to other things. I was trying to distract you too. When I showed you the picture of the smiley face, but then I went on to talk about rainbows, I was trying to distract you. But I'm guessing it didn't work very well. Jesus in the Bible keeps on doing all kinds of good things, and people keep talking about him and telling others about him. No matter what anyone does, if we continue to read Jesus' story, we find out that they can't stop Jesus. And because the crowds get so big, they can't stop people from talking about Jesus' message of love either. This works the same way today. You and I can tell all kinds of people about God and about Jesus and about how great they are, and even when we get distracted, when we remember the stories that we hear in church, we're reminded that we can keep telling people all about God. And so that's part of our message for today, is to remember that it's our job to tell people about God. And it's okay to get distracted. That happens to all of us lots of times. But when we're in a situation where we remember that somebody might want to hear about God's love, we can remember our stories from the Bible, and we can tell them all about God's love. You can do this all the time. Let's pray. Dear Jesus, thank you for being the center of our lives, and even when we're distracted, help us to remember that you are love, you are good, you are here with us. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Let us pray. Gracious God, you know us better than we know ourselves, and so you know the times in our lives when we're full of energy, full of enthusiasm, full of life. And you also know the times when we are tired and stressed, exhausted, and even those times when we feel completely powerless. We pray, Lord, as we worship this day, that you would remind us that in all of these times and everything in between, you are with us. And that even when we feel as though we've run out of all of our energy or all of our power, you are still there with great energy, with great love, and with power beyond our understanding. All this we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. So around here, we lose power a lot. If I had to guess, I'd say that it happens, at our house at least, maybe on average 6 to 8 times each year. I don't know for sure where you live, but if you live around here, I'm guessing that you lose power quite a bit too. The funny thing is, even though it happens so often, when the power goes out, to me, it's always still a strange experience. You know, I go into a room and instinctively switch on the light switch on the wall when I enter the room, expecting the lights to come on, and then I'm a little surprised when they don't, but then I remember, right, the power's out. Jacob and Isaac still try to turn on the TV or use the iPad and wonder why there isn't a signal, and Kathleen and I remind them that when there's no power, there's no TV, there's no Wi-Fi. I forget, a lot of times when the power goes out, not to open the refrigerator and stand there looking for something to eat. I forget to try to keep it closed so that I can keep all of that coldness in there for as long as possible. I always forget, and I go to the fridge looking for something to eat, only to be reminded when that little light inside doesn't come on, oh yeah, the power is still out. Maybe you do the same thing. I think it's easy to take something simple like electricity for granted, only to remember, when it goes out, how much we rely on it. Most of the times, this is just a nuisance. It's annoying. But in the colder months, or in the middle of an especially wet and windy storm, losing power can be a scary thing. We realize we need it for more than just the lights and the TV and a cool refrigerator. We need it to heat our home. We need it to pump the water out of the basement. We need it even to communicate. When the power goes out at our house without Wi-Fi, because my cell phone doesn't have a very good signal there, that phone is practically useless. So there are times when we lose the power, when it's more than just a nuisance, when it's scary. If you live nearby, then you know that power outages happen often. Sometimes they're short, and other times they last longer, and when they do, they cause more and more problems for us. And yet, even without electricity, we still have power, and I think we have more power than we might realize. Our gospel story for today is a scary one, and it has a lot to do with power. Herod and his family have power, lots of it, and because they were afraid of what someone like John the Baptist might do to their power, how he threatened it, John's life comes to a tragic ending. The fear continues for Herod when he wonders about John, whether or not the one he beheaded has been raised from the dead in this powerful person of Jesus he keeps hearing about. Even with power to silence the life of John, there's still fear of losing that power because of someone else. At our house, and maybe you've done the same thing, we've tried to do as much as we can to prepare for when the power goes out. We've taken down trees and trimmed branches, we bought a generator, and all of that is good, but the power still goes out sometimes. It's never our choice. We have no control over when or if it might happen. And when it goes out, all we can do is the best we can do. And sometimes, all we can really do is wait for it to come back. Jesus' power was taken away from him by people like Herod, who saw in Jesus a threat to their own power. Like me, they didn't want the power to go out ever. And they used their power to try to preserve the power they had by eliminating any threat, especially in the form of someone like Jesus. Jesus couldn't save John, and I'm sure that was devastating to him. In the end, he couldn't save himself, but it wasn't because he didn't have the power. Jesus does something that is unbelievable to me. He uses the power that he has to give up everything. The Son of God, who had the power to still storms and multiply loaves and fish and heal the sick, doesn't use any of that power, though I assume he could have, to tear down the cross. For Jesus, it is clear at the end of the story that all of the power has gone out. When he breathes his last breath, when the stone is rolled over the entrance to his grave, the power goes out completely. You and I know what it's like when the storm strikes and the fierce winds blow and the power goes out. We know what it's like to lose the power in our homes, and we know what it's like to lose some of our power when things get stormy in real life. The power outage in our house, even though it's frustrating, is a lot less traumatic than the power outages we experience in our own lives. I have a friend who works for a power company, and I know that when the power goes out, they are working on it. The same thing is true with God. When anything happens to us, anything that threatens our own power, God goes to work for us too. We have power, and it comes from God, and what we do with it matters to God. In the story that follows this one that we read this morning, the next one in Mark's gospel, we hear about an amazing use of power when Jesus uses the power of God to multiply and feed without ending. He knew the power he had and how it came from God, and he used it to give life. He wasn't afraid of it ever going out, and when he uses his power, good things happen for lots and lots of people all the time. Our power comes from God. It starts with God. What we do with it is always connected to God, and we have far more of it than we might realize. What we do with the power we have matters to our God. And thankfully, because of God, because of the cross of Christ, we don't ever have to worry about the power going out for good. In Jesus' name, amen. While we're getting ready for our song of the day, I'll mention some of the congregational announcements for this week. I want to thank Rob and Betty and Kathy for sharing our music this morning. I also want to say a special word of thanks to Nicholas, who is running our computer and our live stream recording software for the first time. Nicholas, we really appreciate it. I want to thank everybody who made a contribution to St. James this week, whether you dropped it off at the church, whether you sent it in by mail, whether you participate in things like direct deposit or bill pay. This means a lot to us, and we really appreciate every contribution. Our mission of the month for July is Adesia Nutrition. Adesia is a nonprofit social enterprise that makes life-saving foods that help solve the world's most alarming health crisis, which is malnutrition. Adesia is a Rhode Island company, and they manufacture ready-to-use therapeutic food. If you're able to make a contribution this week, I know they would appreciate it. And while I mentioned that, the easiest way to make a contribution to St. James is through our website at stjames-ri.org/donate. You'll find a PayPal link on that page, and you can make a donation there. Following our worship, and I'll mention this again later, Nicholas will unmute those of you who are joining via Zoom, and you're welcome to stay and visit with us for as long as you like. Our song of the day is Faith of Our Fathers.
Our hearts beat high with joy.
gazing on high in prison's dark, a cross of Christ still burning bright, faith for today.
Life, you have fed us with your message of joy and salvation and called us to share the good news with all people. Gather what has been sown among us and strengthen us with your word. Make us to be what we receive here, good news for the life of the world. Amen.
Amen.
Come before the triune God in prayer. Holy Parent, you welcome your people into one family and gather all things to yourself. Bestow your grace upon your beloved church. Lavish your wisdom upon us and redeem us from our faults, that by our witness all might praise your glory. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Awesome Creator, you steadfastly tend to the smallest of seeds and the mightiest of sycamore trees. Spring up green growth from the earth. Nourish the growth of fruit, grain, and other crops, and bless the work of farmers and laborers. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of the oppressed, turn the ears of those who are in power to the voices of prophets in our own day. Protect those who speak difficult truths when it is risky to do so. Lord, in your mercy,
Hear our prayer.
God of strength, you are near to those who endure difficulty. Comfort all who are survivors of violence, guard the refugee and the immigrant, and protect all those who are victims of prejudice and discrimination. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
God of love, we pray for this holy house and for all who worship here. We pray especially for those whose efforts behind the scenes often go unnoticed, for those who care for our building, for our office staff, for all of our worship support, and for every volunteer. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
We lift our prayers to you, O God, trusting in your abiding grace. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray.
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name.
Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven.
Give us this day our daily bread,
and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Amen. Once again, thank you for worshiping with us. I want to thank Betty, Kathy, Rob, and I especially want to thank Nicholas for running our computers for the first time today. I want to thank all of you for worshiping with us, and you can find us here on Facebook Live every Sunday morning at 9 a.m. We also worship out in the outdoor parking lot behind the church at 9 a.m. That service includes Holy Communion. If you're unable to find us on Facebook Live or come in person, worship videos are uploaded to YouTube typically Sunday afternoon each week. Let us pray. Gracious God, you have gathered us and you have filled us with your presence and your power. And we pray, Lord, that you would help us to remember this week, in those moments when we're feeling weak or tired or stressed or overwhelmed or even powerless, that we draw on your grace, your love, your unconditional love, and your amazing power. We pray, Lord, that you would fill us with your Spirit when we need it, and that you would guide us to share that power with the world. As we do all of this, Lord, we trust that you will bless us. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
Amen. Amen.
My life is in you, Lord. My strength is in you, Lord. My hope is in you, Lord. In you, it's in you. My life is in you, Lord. My strength is in you, Lord. My hope is in you, Lord. In you, it's in you. I will praise you with all of my life. I will praise you with all of my strength.
Once again, thank you for worshiping with us. I hope that you have a fantastic week. Go in peace. Serve the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
I will praise you with all of my strength. I will praise you with